This video is about how electricity works at the nanoscale. Imagine we have an electron moving in a perfect normal metal, without any scattering or resistance to its motion. We say that the electron is moving ballistically. In other words, the crystal is perfect with no impurities or defects, and the temperature is sufficiently low such that there is minimal jiggling of the atoms or scattering with other electrons. What would be the electron's contribution to the resistance of the material? Would the resistance be zero? Would the classical picture of electricity in terms of electron responding to a local electric field still works? Such a scenario is not mere hypothetical and has in fact been observed experimentally when electricity operates at the nanoscale. It turns out that the ballistic electron would contribute a finite resistance of about 25.8 kiloohms. In terms of conductance, which is the inverse of resistance, it will be 38.7 microsiemens. We call this the von Klitzing resistance or conductance, respectively, which was discovered in 1980. While working with silicon transistor at the High Magnetic Field Laboratory, Klaus von Klitzing made the unexpected discovery that the Hall resistance was exactly quantized. It is given by the Planck constant divided by electronic charge square. But why is the resistance of order kiloohms when the electron moves ballistically across the conductor? Before we can answer this question, we should first address if it's even possible to have a perfect conductor with ballistic electrons in the first place. Indeed, such perfect conducting channel has been observed experimentally in various low-dimensional materials, whose devices are made with the help of nanofabrication. Here is an image of a nanowire conducting channel being contacted by two metal pads, which are the source and drain of electrons. The most prominent example of a ballistic conductor is the carbon nanotube, which consists of carbon atoms arranged in a 2D hexagonal lattice wrapped into a cylinder as shown. The diameter of the cylinder are typically of order a few nanometers, thus the name nanotube. Ballistic electron transport happens when the length of the nanotube is smaller than its mean free path, or the average length where an electron encounters a scattering event. Nanofabrication has enabled the making of such ballistic carbon nanotube transistor. By making contacts to the two ends, one can measure its electrical conductance, G, defined as the ratio of its current to the applied voltage. An additional gate, VG, is often used to tune the number of electrons or conducting modes in the nanotubes. What was observed in experiments was surreal. The measured conductance appear in discrete steps, with the quantum unit being twice the von Klitzing conductance GK, with increasing gate voltage. The quantum conductance, G, can thus be expressed as follows, where M being an integer. The factor of 2 in the quantum conductance is due to the spin degeneracy. Pauli exclusion principle allows for two conducting electron channels, one with spin up and the other spin down as shown. The lifting of this spin degeneracy can be achieved in experiments with a magnetic field. The quantum resistance is just the inverse of the quantum conductance. It starts with the value of half the von Klitzing resistance and decreases by a factor of 2 each time with increasing of the gate voltage. The quantum resistance, R, can thus be expressed as follows, where M being an integer. The factor of 2 is again due to spin. Now that we established what was observed experimentally, we shall take a step back and examine a few key conceptual questions. Since the electrons travels through the conductor without any scattering, what is the physical origin of the measured resistance? In addition, any resistive region should be accompanied by a voltage drop. But if there's no scattering in the nanotube, how can there be any voltage drop? We begin by recognizing the fact that the concept of electric or electrochemical potential is only well defined when we have an equilibrated electron gas. Electrons must be allowed to exchange energy and momentum to establish an equilibrium electrochemical potential energy, herein denoted as mu f. In the ballistic nanotube conductor, where electrons do not interact, mu f is not well defined. On the contrary, the bulky metallic contacts have a well-defined mu f. In other words, when the size of the conductor, L, is much larger than the mean distance between electron scattering event, lambda, We are in the classical regime where equilibrium statistical quantities make sense. Let us first recall the microscopic picture of how electricity flows in a classical ohmic conductor. Connected to metallic contact source and drain, and an electrical bias V is being applied as shown. In this classical limit, electrons encounter multiple scattering events within the conductor. With the application of an applied voltage V, a transient potential energy gradient is readily established across the conductor electromagnetically at the speed of light. Electrons in the conductor respond to this electric field gradient, leading to electron flow from the source to the drain. Over time, they establish a local quasi-electrochemical potential in the conductor region as shown. We refer you to the excellent discussion of how electricity actually works in this classical limit by the channel Veritasium. Now, how do we think about electricity when we are in the opposite limit, where the length of the conductor is much smaller than lambda, such as the case we previously discussed with carbon nanotubes? Since the source and drain are classical metallic contacts, their electrochemical potentials are well defined. The right electrochemical potential is lower due to the applied voltage at the drain contact. But what is the potential energy in the nanotube region? Would there even be a local electrochemical gradient in the conductor region when the electrons are ballistic? A local potential gradient would imply local resistance. But how can there be any resistance when there is no scattering? In this limit, the electron quantum wave character cannot be ignored. Its spatial delocalization extends beyond the length of the conductor. Should electron transport within the conductor be viewed as responding to a local electric field? In 1957, Rolf Landauer from IBM proposed a physically intuitive way to view electron transport through a ballistic conductor. He suggested that electron transport should be viewed from the electrical contacts, where electrons have well-defined equilibrium properties. Landauer viewed each electrical contacts as consisting of a sea of electrons up to the Fermi level. A positive electrical biasing of the right contact pushed its electrons to lower energy as shown. An energy transport window, as highlighted in yellow, is open where metallic states on the right contact are filled, while that on the left contact are empty. Electrons within this energy window are allowed to transport from the left to the right contacts as shown. On the other hand, electrons beneath this energy window are not allowed to flow due to Pauli blocking. Thus, an electrical current can flow only with the opening of the transport window with an applied electrical bias V. In this Landauer picture of electrical transport, one can also explain the origin of the resistance. The effective electrochemical energy in the nanotube should be constant, since the channel is ballistic, thus respecting the fact that the resistance is zero within the conductor. However, its energy can lie anywhere between the source or the drain electrochemical potentials. For symmetrical metallic contacts, it should then reside midpoint of mu L and mu R. The resistance therefore happens right at the metallic contacts and nanotube junction. Thus, the quantum resistance of a ballistic conductor all happens at the two ends of the conductor contacts junction. Now, to complete the story, we shall derive the concrete expression of the contact resistance within this Landauer transport picture. The current is given by the electronic charge multiplied by the velocity, V, and the transport density of states, dt, integrated over the transport energy window. To proceed, we need an expression for V and dt. Consider a characteristic electron energy band dispersion as shown. The electron energy E depends on the electron wave vector K. Boundary conditions would require the electron wave functions along the tube to take on discrete values for K, given by integer multiples of 2 pi divided by L. The electron number, N, is given by the number of wave vectors smaller than K, multiplied by the spin degeneracy of 2. The electron density is then just the electron numbers divided by the length L, and we arrived at 2K divided by pi. The density of states is defined as the differential of the electron density with respect to energy E. Recalling the expression for the electron velocity, we can then express the density of states as a differential in terms of K instead, allowing us to obtain a final expression of D equals to 4 divided by HV. Now, we are ready to evaluate the electrical current. First, we insert the expression for the transport density of states, which is just half of the electron density of states d, since only half of the states are forward propagating. Inserting the expression of d equals to 4 divided by hv, and recognizing that the difference in the mu l and mu are equals to the applied electric potential v, we arrive at an expression for the electrical current. The electrical conductance, which is defined as the current I divided by the voltage V, is then given by 2 times E squared divided by H, which is exactly twice the von Klitzing conductance, or inverse of the Klitzing resistance. Before we depart, we make one final remark. In this video, we discussed how electricity works at the nanoscale and have discussed the quantum resistance as the fundamental unit of electrons' resistance. On the other hand, we have also seen that for large macroscopic circuits, as demonstrated by Veritasium, electricity is described by classical electromagnetism. In this limit, electricity is carried by electromagnetic field, or photon, and the fundamental resistance of a photon in free space is given by 1 divided by the speed of light and free space permittivity, as shown. If we take the ratio of the two resistances, we then arrive at the ubiquitous constant of nature, the fine structure constant alpha, which governs all aspect of electromagnetic interactions. Stay tuned, and subscribe, so you will be notified of our future episodes.